This is the story of Norman and Anne Evans. Little is known about the childhood of Norman's father, Dave. He was not a great talker and spoke sparingly of his early life. Dave was born in Plumstead in 1907, the son of a sergeant in the Abbey Wood Police Force. It was in this area of London that he spent his childhood with his parents and his sister Lily. After attending school at Church Manor Way, he eventually studied engineering at the Technical Poly in the borough. He had a number of health issues over the course of his life. One of the more severe ones occurred when he was 14. Following surgery for a hernia, his left leg ceased growing, and he lived his adult life with one leg 6 inches shorter than the other. After serving an apprenticeship, he found permanent employment making electrical parts at Oliver Powell's on Plumstead Common. It was during this time that he met his future wife, Muriel Plowman. Muriel was born in 1904 and grew up in central London under poorer conditions than Dave. Always an artistic child, she loved making and arranging things for the home. Her mother, Emma, a short, disciplined woman, went on to have two other children, Doug and Marjorie. Muriel adored her father, William, a clerk at the Royal Horticultural Society. Eventually becoming a butler, he succumbed to the powers of alcohol and died early from cirrhosis of the liver. The family moved to Woolwich, where Muriel entered the workforce at the age of 14, moving from office work at the arsenal to enter into service as a parlor maid. One afternoon, she struck up a conversation with a young man, Dave, at a bus stop in Charlton. He accompanied her home, they saw each other regularly, and although Dave's parents looked down on Muriel as unworthy of their son, they were married in August 1928. One year passed, and Muriel gave birth, after a long and painful labor, to her only child, Norman. Anne's father, Herbert Wills, was born in Plumstead in 1903. Although adoring of his mother, he grew up very much in the shadow of his father, Frederick, a blacksmith at the munitions arsenal in Woolwich. Frederick loved socializing and spent liberally on friends, clothes, and drinking at the pub. He neglected his two boys, Herbert and his sickly brother, Victor. As a youth, Herbert was a loving and generous boy and an enthusiastic Rover Scout. He loved roughing it on camping trips. Frederick desired his son to follow him into the arsenal, but young Herbert had an independent mind and chose to become an engineer. He began work just like Dave Evans at Oliver Powell's on Plumstead Common and was a fast and hard worker who learned quickly. Herbert grew to despise his father, who eventually abandoned his dying wife for another woman. One night at a Rover Scouts dance, the 21-year-old Herbert met a young lady, Emily Giel. Her flamboyance and energy so excited him that he took the bold step of running off with her face powder. He knew she would have to talk to him if she wanted it back. He asked her out, and they were soon courting. Of course, Herbert's father did not like Emily. Frederick had wanted his son to marry a family friend. Herbert, or Bert, as Emmy called him, was later to describe how proud he was of her, not for her looks, but for her personality, as she was always the center of attention. Emmy was born in 1899, and she too had spent her childhood in Plumstead. The first 5 years were in a foster home, as her mother had died of pneumonia when Emmy was a baby. Her father, Edward, was a strict man who struggled financially for many years as he passed through periods of unemployment and menial labor. He eventually remarried, and Emmy moved back in with him and his new wife. The couple went on to have two additional children, Ina and Les, but Edward died of stomach cancer when Emmy was just 23. Edward would never speak to his daughter about her birth mother. She did learn, though, that like her, she loved to sing. As Emmy grew to maturity, people were drawn to her zest for life and brash confidence. After Herbert had made his bold play for her attentions, he began working for Mitchell's Construction, where he was required to do much traveling. He missed his sweetheart and chose to marry her rather than be apart any longer. They were married on a June day in 1926 at St. Margaret's Church on Plumstead Common, and after a brief honeymoon in Eastbourne, started their life together on the road. For 6 years, they had no fixed home, but traveled around the country from one engineering project to the next. They continued doing this even after the birth of their first child, Betty, but sadly realized that this existence must soon end when Emmy became pregnant with her second child, Anne. Buying a newly built house adjacent to Bostall Heath, this was to remain their home for the next 50 years. Two months after moving in, Anne was born, July 1932. Norman had a happy childhood. His father became employed as a precision toolmaker in the British defense industry. In 1933, they were able to afford a house on Fairwater Avenue in Welling. Dave used his free time to cultivate their 100-foot-long garden with vegetables and flowers, as well as building a fish pond and a chicken coop. Muriel enjoyed working with crafts, as well as making outfits for her son. As an only child, Norman was eager to run and play with neighborhood boys, climbing under garden hedges, mischievously playing tricks on neighbors, and catapulting lumps of clay into the sky. He also loved to play bicycle hockey in the school playground, as well as going to Saturday morning cinema to watch Flash Gordon and Tarzan. In the summers, he would visit his father's parents at Holland-on-Sea, where he would pick apples in the large garden. At other times, Norman would visit his mother's family, who had moved to the village of Elam in Kent. There, he would play football with his Uncle Ernie and ride on the back of Ernie's motorcycle to watch village cricket matches. He would play target practice and shoot rabbits with his Uncle Doug's air rifle. Norman was in Elam the day a siren sounded in the village to announce war with Germany. Afraid to return to London, he stayed in Elam with his mother, and later, when daylight raids began, he would watch as the sky filled with planes engaged in deadly dogfights. The men left for war, and the army moved into the village, setting up tents all around. Eventually, Muriel, missing her husband, returned with Norman to London, where bombing was a nightly event. One evening, Dave watched from the top of Shooter's Hill as the London docklands blazed with fire and filled the night sky with light. Wartime brought additional pressures on Dave. Working much more, he had less time with his family. For an extended period, they all moved to Horsham, where Dave worked on the development of guns able to shoot down enemy missiles. For Norman, war was a bizarre experience. Scouring the streets for shrapnel, shell tops, and downed planes, he would often come upon the horrific results of the bombing. Night times were spent out of doors in the Anderson shelter, where they would try to sleep as the bombs dropped and the big guns roared. Through all this, Norman's education suffered, and he finished school with a mediocre education. The most significant event of this period occurred in 1943, when the family were contacted by Jehovah's Witnesses. After listening to a gramophone lecture by then-President Judge Rutherford, they chose to study the religion. Muriel took to it immediately, liking the teachings, the more relaxed meetings, and friendly nature of the people. Norman mainly enjoyed the social aspects of spending time with other youngsters. It was not until 1946 that he began to take the religious side more seriously. War ended in 1945, and after the jubilant street parties, Norman finished his education by attending a technical school, where he became proficient in shorthand and typing. His parents had not encouraged or guided him toward any particular career, so it was with these skills that he started his first job in 1946 at the age of 17 as an office junior in London. After work, he enjoyed exploring the ruins of war-ravaged London, and it was at this time he began buying recordings of classical music with his spare money. Unlike his parents, who showed no great interest, Norman became an avid listener, a passion that is with him to this day. It was also at this time that Norman purchased a quarter plate camera for 10 shillings and began developing his own photographs. This also has been an interest that has not waned to this day. Norman began spending time at weekends with friends from work, visiting them in Ilford, swimming, and going for walks. A point came, though, when he chose to turn his back on this and take the witness organization more seriously. In 1947, with his friends Valerie Campion and Brenda Ford, he began full-time door-to-door ministry. To manage financially, he went through a series of part-time jobs, breaking up firewood, packing envelopes, setting print type, and collecting money for Parsons printers. He enjoyed his door-to-door preaching, becoming an able speaker, and loved being free from the daily grind of traveling to London. In early 1948, Len Dunslow invited Norman to accompany him on a Bible study he had with a mother and two daughters. He found the mother to be very lively, although a little bossy. He liked the older daughter, Betty, who was also quite animated. He was less attracted to the younger and quieter daughter, Anne, whose teeth were in bad condition. Socially, Norman enjoyed the time he spent with Brenda Ford and her family. They would involve themselves playing instruments and singing opera arias. This all came to an abrupt end later that year, when after receiving a call for military service, he refused as a conscientious objector and was sentenced to a year in prison. At first, he was locked up in Canterbury Prison, which he found hard. He spent his days on the yard squad, breaking up concrete with a sledgehammer, digging into the frozen winter soil. This was followed by a stretch in Lewis Prison, which was much easier. He was given the job of librarian with the freedom to roam. Norman used his spare time transcribing the violin concerto of Jean Sibelius. With three visits a week from friends, he found that the time passed quickly, and he was released after 8.5 months served. Anne was a quieter and shyer child than her sister Betty. She had a childhood hampered by several stretches of sickness, scarlet fever, rheumatic fever, pneumonia, and whooping cough. Caring for this sick child alone, it upset Emmy that her husband was rarely home with his family. Bert tried for a short period a more settled employment at Vickers in Crayford, but this was short-lived as Mitchell Construction lured him back with better pay. For the next 35 years he was to travel, rarely returning home to Canberra Road to see his family. Anne missed her father, but Emmy was not going to let her absent husband damage her own social life. She quickly became involved with the local church and the Conservative Party, where she would organize concert parties. At these parties, she would often sing and perform sketches. For Bert, his life revolved around work, family, and catching up on household projects when he was home. Emmy proved to be a fun and easygoing mother. She gave her daughter Anne the freedom to explore with her friends Hillary and Jill. After the outbreak of war in 1939, Emmy and the two girls were evacuated first to Suffolk, then Wiltshire. After the Blitz, they returned home to London. What with her sicknesses and the war interrupting her schooling, Anne left school at the age of 16 with a poor education. She began work in Northumberland Heath as a dental assistant and receptionist, and she remained there until her marriage to Norman in 1955. In her spare time, she loved to dance and sing, taking evening classes to improve her skills. When young Norman Evans began visiting their house for Bible studies in 1948, her family would crowd around the piano afterwards to sing accompaniment while he played. She thought this young man handsome and enjoyed the time she spent with him. On returning home from prison, Norman discovered that the girl he had been unimpressed by the previous year, Ann Wills, had had her teeth fixed at Guy's Hospital. She was looking much more attractive, so much so, in fact, that he started giving her some serious attention. Anne took a week off of work, and they spent it together in the witness ministry, getting to know each other. Norman started to see many things he liked in the character of this young lady. He hounded her. Whenever she would leave work at lunchtime or evening, he would be waiting with his bicycle, ready to walk her home. He asked her out to see the toast of New Orleans. Anne was flattered, and they kissed afterwards in the garden shed. This was the beginning of a courtship that lasted 4 years. Norman, at this time, due to his witnessing activity, had little money. He would cycle home in bare feet so as not to damage his only pair of shoes. Norman knew he would need more money if he was to marry, but he didn't want to return to working in London. Dave decided to help his son set up his own business. He purchased an old-fashioned printing press and lots of lead type. Norman rented a shop on Sandcliffe Road in Erith, and so began a year-long unsuccessful attempt to run a business. He soon realized this printing endeavor was not going to make enough money for a married couple. In 1953, Norman saw a newspaper ad asking for a compositor at Siebel's Toy Factory in Erith. He got the job and started saving for the wedding. During this period, Norman's responsibilities within Jehovah's Witnesses had been increasing dramatically. By the age of 19, he had become a ministerial servant, and in 1952, at the age of 23, he was congregation servant, responsible for all aspects of the Plumstead congregation. This responsibility continued for the next 20 years, becoming congregation servant in Woolwich and also Dartford. On July 16, 1955, Anne and Norman were married. Norman walked to his wedding in a borrowed suit, but the day was joyous, with a wonderful reception for 50 guests at Shornell's on Bostall Heath. After their reception, Anne and Norman traveled by night train to the peaceful fishing village of Salcombe in Devon for the first week of their honeymoon. For the second week, they traveled to London's Twickenham Stadium for its very first five-day assembly of Jehovah's Witnesses. Returning home to Plumstead, their domestic life together began. They had been able to save up enough money to buy a house at 56 Cotswold Road in Plumstead. Home life involved much time spent with family and witnesses, listening to music, and occasionally going out to the movies. Anne learned to cook through a trial and error process. She found laundry more difficult, with no boiler or washer. She tried using a mangle, but eventually took the washing in a suitcase to a laundrette. After a couple of years, they desired a baby, and Anne fell pregnant immediately with her first son, Nigel. She gave birth on March 28, 1958. After childbirth, Anne spent 2 weeks in hospital. She was allowed one visitor a week, and Anne was only permitted to see her newborn son at feed time. On returning home, they were overwhelmed. Nigel was a difficult baby. In the evenings, he would scream with colic. Although she went on to have 4 more children, Anne's best birthing experiences were with Nicola and Timothy, born at home with midwives. After the birth of their second child, Nicola, in 1961, the limitations of the house on Cotswold Road, with its outdoor bathroom and small garden, were making themselves ever more apparent. They chose to move to a 3-bedroom house in Dartford. Shortly after setting up home on Hawthorne Road, Anne became pregnant again with her second son, Timothy. It was to be these three children growing up together for the next 7 years. They each had very distinct personalities. Nigel, well-behaved, studious, and diligent. Nicola, mischievous and naughty. Timothy, happy but impetuous. The children enjoyed the estate they lived in, with its small playground adjacent the house and large garden with fruit trees. They formed friendships from within the neighborhood. Norman and Anne also formed friendships in the local congregation, and this was for Norman the happiest and most fulfilling time he had in his role as congregation servant. Norman's work responsibilities were changing around this time also. He started assisting in the graphic design department of Siebel's. Norman quickly became responsible for the photography, layout, and printing of brochures and instructional leaflets for the new toys being produced. During this period, both Herbert and Dave retired. It was an opportunity for Dave and Muriel to move away from London to the village of Bridge in Kent. Settling down in their newly built bungalow, they enjoyed the pastoral surroundings, as well as the opportunity to pursue their interest in crafts such as making jewelry, metalwork, and flower arranging. Emmy and Bert stayed in their house in Canberra Road, but took advantage of the opportunity to travel overseas, as well as to spend more time with their grandchildren. The children have many happy memories of vacations from this period. After moving up from a motorcycle and sidecar to a van, Norman took his family away on various camping expeditions to Devon, Wales, Scotland, and the Lake District. Another anticipated event was the Friday visit from Anne's parents. With Bert now retired, he could assist Anne in the weekly shopping. Emmy would take care of the children, treating them with candy, games, and pocket money. In November 1969, a fourth child was born, Peter. And it was at this time that the size of the Dartford house became an issue. After a wide-ranging search, Anne and Norman found a large 5-bedroom house in Bexley Heath, just a mile away from Anne's parents. Although needing extensive work, they grabbed at the opportunity to have so much space, and they moved in April 1971. Thus began a period that was more troubled and stressful for all the family. For Norman, he had the responsibilities for making larger monthly house payments, as well as needing to finish extensive remodeling on the new house. It would need rewiring, re-roofing, and decorating. A short time later, he lost his job as Siebel's went out of business. After a period of unemployment, he found his new post to be much more demanding of his time, with extensive traveling required. With Peter still a baby, Anne found herself pregnant with a fifth child, David. As she was leaving for the hospital to give birth, she fell and broke her arm, an event that so shocked Emmy she came down with severe shingles. Norman's father, Dave, had an accident and slipped a disc in his back. Instead of recovering, his health declined, as the effects of cancer started to ravage his body. Norman visited his parents by traveling down to Bridge at the weekends, but in 1974, Dave Evans passed away. The time Anne and Norman could spend with their older children was limited, as the kids in turn struggled to adjust to new routines, surroundings, and schools. The children had no comprehension of the strain and pressure their parents were under. Eventually, Norman's work stresses eased as he became the director of a small startup company, Saba, involved in the import and marketing of bicycle parts. He took on some responsibilities again within the Witness organization, and his mother moved from Bridge to live close by. The three generations of the family were able to spend much time together during the remaining years of Muriel, Emily, and Herbert's lives. Emmy and Bert were very attached to Anne's youngest boy, David. He would spend much time at their house on Canberra Road, where she would spoil him. He was with Emmy the day in 1981 that she broke her wrist, an accident that began her slow decline into death the following year from stomach cancer. Bert was shattered by the loss of his wife, and although he stayed busy for the following year, after a brief hospitalization, he died of heart failure. After the collapse of Norman's employer, Saba, he chose to set up his own import-export business, Seaway Marketing. By taking the money they had inherited from Anne's parents, Norman started working from home. The house became filled with boxes of clothes and bicycle parts. He gradually expanded, moving from one warehouse to another in the search for more space. Eventually, he bought his own warehouse and office in Erith. In the time Norman ran the business, he met with considerable success, enabling him to employ two of his sons and save up for his retirement in 1997. Nigel was the first of the children to move away from the family home. After leaving school at the age of 16, he spent several years in full-time door-to-door ministry, during which time he met Susan Boych, a friend of his cousin's. In 1979, when Nigel was 21, they married and set up home in Woolwich and then Plumstead, where they live together to this day with their two children, Matthew and Clara. Nigel moved into computer programming in his mid-20s and has found considerable success working in this field. He has also stayed busy within Jehovah's Witnesses, gaining much responsibility within his congregation. In 2004, Susan and he celebrated their silver wedding anniversary together. Nicola went through a series of secretarial jobs in London before choosing to spend her time in full-time ministry. While engaged in this on the small Scottish island of Tiree, she met her future husband, Nicholas Black. When they were married in 1995, it was an opportunity for the extended family to come together again. They moved into a small house in the town of Stamford in the middle of England, and they live there today with their two children, Charlotte and Thomas. Timothy, after leaving school in 1982, began work in the electronics industry while continuing his studies for several years. In 1990, he moved to California to be with and eventually marry his girlfriend, Lisa Berry. Although they were to later divorce, they had the opportunity to have a wonderful daughter together, Madison, who shares her time between her parents in San Francisco and Petaluma. Timothy still works in electronics today, and in his spare time makes films. Peter, after leaving school at age 16, began working in the door-to-door ministry while also working part-time for his father. Later on, he chose to work full-time there, gradually taking on more responsibility as he learned different aspects of the business. In 1997, he was able to buy Seaway Marketing from Norman and take full control for himself. He has continued its successes. In 1996, he married his sweetheart, Demet, and after living briefly in Barnhurst, they moved out to the village of Aylesford in Kent. David also worked for Norman, but unlike Peter, he chose to explore other paths. After traveling around the world for a year in 2000, he settled in Brighton, where he went back to school to study sociology. In the summer of 2005, he completed his courses and proudly became the first family member to have a bachelor's degree. Norman and Anne still live in their home of 34 years on Belvedere Road. They stayed very close to Norman's mother, Muriel, who lived close by and who they cared for all the way to her death at the age of 96. Retired now, Anne and Norman are still active within the Witness organization and stay close with their children and grandchildren. On the 16th of July, 2005, the family came together for Norman and Anne's golden wedding anniversary to honor them and to say thank you for all they have done.